right, we're continuing our series on freedom, discovering the divine you. And what that simply means is this. Like I said in the very beginning when I said, welcome to everyone. We believe every single person is made in the image of God, and that God has plans for you before he even created the world, that you are here for a reason. And we want to help everyone to discover the divine you. Why are you alive and what God has for you to do? That's true freedom. Not just getting saved and giving your life to Christ. As awesome and as important and as essential as that is. There's nothing more important. But after we find who we are, we're with Christ, then we want to discover the reason why we're alive. And that brings freedom. When you have a purpose, it helps you stay on the right track. If you don't have a purpose in your life, it's easy to get off track. And so we've been talking about freedom and how to find freedom. We've been talking about it for weeks. And I think that this is number six, I believe it is. We're in the process. And we talked a couple of weeks ago about how freedom can come, and freedom can come in our lives, and how that we are in a spiritual battle. And Jesus spoke to the church of his day and says, you shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. And they said, we've never been in bondage to anybody. And Jesus said the following, he who sins is in bondage. All of us, we all of us struggle with sin issues. And so we are in bondage, but our objective is to become freer in Christ Jesus. And we spoke about it. I'm going to go ahead and read this verse for you today. 1 John 2:16, it says this. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh. Today we're going to be talking about the lust of the flesh on Valentine's Day. Isn't that great? Yes, it is. We're talking about the lust of the flesh today. The lust of the eyes we dealt with last week. And then the pride of life is the big parents of all of them. Pride is the major issue in all of our lives. That's the master key that opens the doors for everything, and we talked about that. We also spoke about the fact that when they translated the Greek and the Hebrew and the Aramaic to King James Version, which is a great version, they used the word possessed when they dealt with demons, a demon possessed, which gives a connotation that if you are demon possessed, a demon controls you and you have no ownership. That's not at all. Actually, in this Greek, it says demonized. And so Christians can be influenced by evil spirits. Make no mistake about it. Doesn't mean they have ownership. They can influence and they can infest your life, just like you can have pests infest your home. Termites, roaches, rats. I don't know who has rats, but anyhow, whatever. That can happen. You can be influenced. Just like if you take if you drink, you can be influenced under the influence. It may not control you, but it has influence on you. And if you open certain doors to the enemy, he tries to get jurisdiction in our lives. He has to get permission. We found out from the book of Job. And so, for example, let me just stop here for a second. I want to just bring a little bit of context to help us out because I feel people going, oh, no, he's getting weird. Talking about demons and angels. I want to make something abundantly clear. God is so much stronger than the enemy. It's not even funny. We mentioned last week that what we're dealing with here is a terrorist. The enemy, the devil, is a terrorist. He's a terrorist organization called Fallen Angels. They're not even close to being as strong as God. Not even close. But the power they yield, the nuclear arsenal they use, is the nuclear weapon of lies. If the enemy can get us to believe a lie can control us. He doesn't have the power. So what he has to do is lie to us, get us to believe a lie. If we believe a lie, whether it's true or not, if you believe something, it operates in your life. It's bad programming. And so what we want to do is renew our minds with the word of God. And so he is a terrorist. And so Jesus said, you shall know the truth, and that truth is Jesus Christ, and the truth will set you free. Well, the truth sets you free. What gets you in bondage? A lie. And so what we really need to be doing all the time, that's why it's so important every day to get your mind bathed in the word of God. You need to get the truth in here to change our ways. And that's a battlefield of the mind, no doubt about it. But today I want to talk about this, defeating lust with love. Defeating lust with love. I'm going to talk about some stuff today. I'm going to step on some toes. And last week I stepped on some toes. I'm going to get another controversial issue because the Bible deals with issues that are controversial because it goes to the core of who we are. I want to ask you to open your Bibles for a moment, please. 1 Corinthians 6:18. And we're going to read something here. We're going to deal with the topic of sexuality this morning because it's such a powerful topic. And I don't care who you are. If you watch the Super Bowl, you put the television on, how many people know that it's constantly before us? We're constantly told What about sexuality? Well, you need to be this way, you need to be the other way. And it's constantly being sold to us continually. It's being broadcast really strongly. This is what the Bible has to say about it. It says in 1 Corinthians 6:18, says this, flee. Let me stop right there. The word flee in the Greek means run out as if your house is on fire. I mean, that's kind of, it's a very strong word. It doesn't even give a suggestion. It's a command. It's an imperative in the grammar. It says flee, run, get out. Don't negotiate, eject. It's like if a pilot is flying an airplane, it's going to crash. He doesn't say, well, he hits the eject button. I'm not taking any chances. I'm out of here. The Bible says flee. Why? Is it because God is out there to spoil our fun? Oh, God's kind of, oh, I can't believe they're doing that. No, that's not what God's doing. God designed sexuality. God designed sexuality between a man and a woman and a marriage for a lifetime. That's how he has designed it. Now, it's sad that that's controversial to say today, but it's the truth. Every other methodology beyond that is a deviation from God's design. A deviation from God's design will bring destruction and hurt upon my life and your life. It's so clear. I'm going to share with you a few moments about that. It says this, flee sexual immorality. Immorality means immorality, the wrong way of utilizing sexuality, whatever it could be in its various forms, whether it's thinking about something, involving something, or talking about something. It says flee sexual immorality. Listen to this. Every sin that a man or woman does is outside the body, but he or she, because that's the context of today, who commits means participates, commits to action, not just I made a mistake. I'm talking about committing. I'm committed. If someone's committed to something, they're committed. Committed sexual immorality sins against the Lord. What does it say there? No, sins against his own body. What is that supposed to mean? It means that misusing sex hurts you. It's actually bad for you. It's not because God doesn't want us having fun. Remember, God put all our nerve endings where they are. He gave us all the emotions. He's the one that gives you that wonderful loving feeling when you're intoxicated with a person's love. I look in your eyes. I mean, we have a whole Bible. We have a whole book of the Bible, the Song of Solomon, which is a love letter to celebrating the beautiful relationship between a man and a woman in a marriage. God designed it. It's a beautiful thing. Nothing to be ashamed of. In fact, it's beautiful. It's vital for our society to be able to participate in the way that God has designed it to do. However, if you misuse sexuality within the context of marriage, you end up hurting yourself. Fire on a day like today is a nice thing. You've heard it before, but a fireplace is a place to put a fire. It does amazing things, fire in a fireplace, but fire outside the fireplace will burn down a home or business. And sex without the context of marriage will burn you and there'll be damage and you'll hurt yourself. Why is it that way? Why is it that we'll continue to read here? It says this, verse 19. Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, which is in you? The Bible also says, he who joins himself with a harlot becomes one flesh with him. The two shall become one flesh. Every time you get involved with someone sexually, okay, this is what happens. Your soul and the other person's soul go like this, they go like this. A couple years ago, I had a sermon series called Money, Sex, and Power. The church grew during that time. Anyhow, in one of the illustrations I gave, I took a picture of a man and a picture of a woman on two boards, and I took some wood glue and put them together. And then what I did is I pulled them apart, and what I did, there were shards of the woman, shards of the man. There was a piece on each person that God has created. Why is the enemy after sexual union for? I'll tell you the reason why. It's because it's called procreation. It brings life. There's something spiritual that happens when a man and a woman come together because it is a potential for a new life. It is a sacred act that God has ordained to bring a husband and wife closer together and to create life. The enemy's objective is to kill, rob, destroy, and steal. He wants to kill the life of your marriage. He wants to kill the life of your children. Why? Because making love in the true sense of the word through sexual union brings two people together, become one flesh. for one lifetime. That's its design. Now, I understand some of you have been through a couple of different marriages. We're not here to bang anyone around or kick you around. We understand we all have fallen, but God's a God of new beginnings. This is not a message of condemnation. This is a message of warning and a message of life. Please understand, I'm not here to get upset everyone. That's not my objective. My objective is to show the Word of God. This is a huge area, the lust of the flesh, and I believe the sexuality that we're talking about today is a great illustration to deal with all lust in general, because it's so central to what we talk about in our society. It's also, it's the one that sins against your own body. Two should be one flesh. If you're the devil and you want to destroy God's creation, you want to do the thing that hurts the most and destroys the most. And sexuality is a great way to bring destruction upon a society. Make no mistake about it. Think of all the countless diseases that happen, all the psychological problems people have. I mean, if we were to tally up all the pharmaceutical industry and how much they're prescribing medication for people that are struggling with depression, anxiety, a lot of it stems from broken sexuality. Not all of it. A lot of the diseases we have. Why? Because two shall become one flesh and one lifetime. When you just keep doing that, you keep doing that, you keep hurting the inside of who you are. And you actually damage yourself. And because God loves us, he doesn't want to see us damage ourselves. I don't want to see my children damaging themselves. Dad, I can do what I want. And they keep hitting themselves or banging themselves up. I'm going to be upset. They keep drinking poison. I'm going to be upset as a parent. Why? Because I love my children. God loves us. The enemy understands, if I can get their sexuality, then I can screw up the family, I can screw up their bodies, I can screw up society. Make no mistake today. So, what I'm going to do today is something a little bit different. We're actually going to read the Bible. We do that every week, but we're going to actually read an entire passage of Scripture. If you could please open your Bibles to Proverbs chapter 7. Proverbs is an amazing, amazing book written by Solomon, predominantly Solomon, the wisest king that was. And he is, we believe that towards the end of his life, he wrote this. And so I want to read this to you because it is a phenomenal illustration about lust, how to deal with it, what are the stages of lust, and how we overcome it. Okay, so we're going to do that right now. Let me pray again. Father, I recognize, Lord, that I'm talking about a very controversial and a very sensitive subject. Lord, I just pray that there'd be no condemnation. In other words, that instead there'd be conviction that we can set a better path. Open our hearts and our minds to receive your life-giving message today in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, it is so dry. I need to get a little bit of water here. Excuse me. All right. Here we go. This is Solomon speaking. He says the following. And when he says my son, it means everybody, okay? This is a literal thing that takes place, but it also, I believe, demonstrates an illustration of how a spirit of lust works within our life. Here we go. Chapter 7, verse 1. My son, keep my words. Keep my words. And treasure my commands. It's keep. If you treasure something, you put it in a safe place. If you treasure something, you put it in a place that will be taken care of. It says, my son, keep my words. Keep them and treasure them. Why? Why? Treasure my commandments within you. Keep my commands and live. Live. In other words, you keep my commands and treasure them, you will live. It's life to you. The words of God are life. My son, keep my words and treasure my commandments within you. Keep my commands and live. And the law as the apple of your eye. Another apple of the eye is a little dark thing in the middle of your eye. In other words, keep it right before you. Keep my laws and my ways right before you. Because if you do not do that, you're going to get distracted and go the wrong way. You got to keep God's grace and his purposes before us. If not, you can begin to walk in the wrong way. Keep it as the apple of your eye. Bind them to your fingers. So wherever your hand does, remember, I'm keeping my commandments. It's almost like this. I have a marriage ring on it. It reminds me, I'm married. I have a covenant with my wife. It's constant. It's bound upon my hand as a reminder. Bind them on your fingers. Write them on the tablet of your heart. How do you write something on the tablet of your heart? The only way you write something on the tablet of your heart is you got to, first of all, understand it up here. Then you have to meditate. And I'm going to say something that's going to be a little bit weird, but bear with me. You have to fantasize the word of God until it gets into your life. What does that mean? You have to mentally think of scenarios of how it's going to apply in your life. an Olympic athlete will begin to, they teach them to close their eyes and they begin to think of themselves like a diver. Going off the diving board, they think, I'm going to do three flips and I'm going to do a, they think of what they're going to do. They meditate upon it. They think about it. Well, what we need to do is take God's word and meditate. How is this going to work at work? How is this going to work in my marriage? And begin, yes, to actually compose a movie in your mind of how it's going to work. What that does is it begins to write on the tablet of your heart. When you begin to imagine, when you begin to meditate and think about and apply, it gets chiseled in your heart. And then it's a lot easier. Now it becomes a part of your internal mechanism. No longer, it's something that begins to run in you. You see that? So this is all part of it. It says this. Write them on the tablet of your heart. Say to wisdom, you're my sister. In other words, this is my family. You're my sister. And call understanding your nearest kin, that they may keep you from the immoral woman. And this is not about coming against woman. This is coming against immorality in general. And so we're going to use this passage as a historical passage, I believe. It's also a way to explain how the spirit of lust works. Immoral woman, excuse me. That they would keep them from the immoral woman. All right? So we're out ready to see how Solomon sees the spirit of lust in action, starting at verse 6 in a few moments. They keep you from the immoral woman, from the seductress who flatters with her words. Now, I don't know if you recognize, but men and women are a little different from each other. I know that's really controversial to say, but God made man and woman. They have equal value but different function in many ways. And generally speaking, men tend to respond to the eyes. We see something, we respond to it. Women, generally speaking, tend to respond to flattering of words, whether it's written word, a texting word, whatever it could be, messaging word, whatever it is. And so the seductress who flatters with her words. I've seen it many, 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 many times. Oh, you look beautiful today. Wow, you're gorgeous. Oh, well, you're gorgeous. I mean, it's inappropriate for a man to go up to a woman that's not his wife and say, you're gorgeous. I mean, that's just flattering. You're putting, sending out the wrong messages. You're saying, I'm open for business. I'm on the prey. I want to get you. That's what you're saying. That's what you're saying. I mean, I've heard people even say this. Oh, she's my work spouse. What? Don't say that. That's crazy. That's dumb. Do not say, that's my work spouse. That's foolishness. Don't say stuff like that. Boy, you gorgeous. Boy, you're make me enough to leave my, I heard people say this. Boy, you're so gorgeous, I would leave my wife over you. I mean, I'm just joking. Don't say stuff like that. That's dumb. Dumb. So your flattery of her words. Now, here we go. Look what he says here. Verse 6. From out the window of my house, I looked through the lattice. Look through a little area, okay? And I saw among the simple, I perceived among the youths, a man devoid of understanding. Now, he's not coming against the youth culture. He's just saying, I've seen people that are ignorant, do not know better, and they're making a big mistake. And this is why my son, listen to me. This whole book is about guiding the next generation to make wise choices in part. I looked through the window of my house, and through my lattice, I saw among the simple, I perceived among the youths, a young man devoid of understanding. He didn't get it. Okay? Verse 8, passing along the street near her corner, and he took the path to her house. Notice, he did it.
Well, I don't know what happened. I don't know how I ended up there. I don't know how it happened.
What do you mean how it happened? You end up going by her desk. You end up taking her out to lunch. You end up meeting at a hotel.
I don't know what happened. It just ended up happening.
We make a path. Well, I just can't believe. Or if you're watching, my goodness, I can't believe they had that stuff going on. This movie star is wearing this type of thing. Click, click, but going. Oh, I just want to see what's going on. Click, click. No one. There I am. Or, oh, wow, I haven't seen her since high school. I wonder how beautiful she is now. Click, click. Oh, wow. Oh, I'm gonna take a little path by that person. That's dumb. D-U-M-B. Okay, it's foolish. Don't do that. Don't go by her path. Don't go by his path. Don't walk by it. Do not be silly and give yourself into temptation. Why? Because this will destroy you, folks. Let's continue to read. and passing along the street near her corner, and he took, verse 8, he took a path to her house. In the twilight, in the evening, in the black of night, everyone's in bed now. It's just me and my Facebook account. It's just me and the internet. Of course, Google knows all about you. And so you're sitting there. No one knows. I'm away on business. I'm all by myself. I'm going to go down to the bar in the hotel. And there's going to be some pretty young ladies down there. I just need to have a little fellowship. Or I'm going to fly and see an old sweetheart who now is living in the town where I'm doing business. Or let me just go ahead and now that they're away. In the twilight, my mother used to say this, nothing good happens after 12 o'clock. She's absolutely right. When you're tired, you're at the end of the day, you make poor choices in the darkness of night. If you can't engage in a relationship in broad daylight, then you shouldn't engage in a relationship. Is that clear? Okay. So, the wrong time, the wrong place. That's how the spirit of lust works. You walk by it, let me just take a look. And then it's dark, it's secret. Verse 10, and there a woman met him. Oh, gee, how did that happen? With the attire of a harlot and a crafty heart. Now, I'm about to say something. I'm going to offend some people, and I'm going to say it ahead of time. I'm sorry. I'm going to offend you. But the Bible is very clear. There's two things here. I'm going to start with the women first. It says here, with the attire of a harlot and a crafty heart. A crafty heart would be a man who is really eloquent with his words. Oh, you're so beautiful. I can't believe your husband does that to you. He doesn't know how beautiful you are, how wonderful you are. You're an amazing woman. You're an amazing young lady. You're beautiful. If you really love me, oh, honey, I love you. I'll give my life to you. And start singing all these syrupy Chicago songs from the 1980s for all of you that are old like me. You know, all these beautiful, oh, you're so gorgeous, all the flattery, you're so intelligent, you're a good wife, oh. And you're like, man, I'm gonna get my hair done just for him. I'm gonna get that outfit just for him. All right, I'm enjoying myself. Okay, that's that part. This is the attire of a harlot. We're not about wearing a burqa and having a slit for your eyes to look through and you have to wear black. And no, we're not suggesting that. But if you're wearing clothes that are accentuating the parts of your body that are utilized for sexual intimacy, it's not a wise thing to do. Why? Because men, generally speaking, are visual. So why are you going to wear a dress? Well, I'm going to get into that right now. I'm going to put images in your mind. Why are you going to wear clothes that are going to accentuate sexuality? Now, I'm not suggesting we wear hefty bags. What are you wearing? I don't know. I'm wearing a bathrobe I had in sixth grade. No, we're not suggesting you wear junk. And a lot of the fashion today is very sexualized. It is. It's inappropriate. Why? Because it causes people, and ladies, let me tell you something right now. Men do not respect a woman who's that sexualized. They don't. If a woman is easy, men really don't respect it. But if a woman has standards and says, I have standards, you've got to work hard for me, they have a lot more respect for you. And so to dress in a way that's now you can wear nice clothes, you can show, yeah, you're in shape, I get that, but you don't have to show your shape for crying out loud, right? And same with men. I know, I have to be very careful what I wear because I'm very, very good shape. Like a pear. But anyhow. but I'm just serious. Enough said with that. I think you get what I'm saying. Do you not get what I'm saying? Just be careful how you dress, please. Remember, there's men, there's brothers and sisters out there. You don't cause them to stumble. It's not worth it. Okay, let's move on. That was a hard one to go for, but I'm going to continue on. It says this, she was loud and rebellious. Hey, make no mistake, is our culture not loud and rebellious about sex? Man, we were watching television the other day with my son, and unfortunately we were watching something. I don't know what we were watching. It was something innocuous like Full House or something like that. It was a nice television program. You know, it was clean. And there's this commercial, and people are kissing each other, if you know what I mean. And there's all sorts of scenarios taking place, including what was just passed in our country for the appropriate manner for marriage. They were showing that happening on television on normal hours. I'm like, my gosh. And it's just putting it up. It's bold. It's brash, right? You go to the supermarket. You go to work. You're at work, and the business outfits or whatever, and it's brash. Or someone comes to you and says, you smell beautiful or whatever. It's brash. It's bold. It's in your face. Make no mistake. She was loud and rebellious. Is it not bold? Yeah. Her feet would not stay at home. In other words, she would not do the right thing. The spirit of lust is not in the right place. At times, she was outside. Imagine that. In the open square. In other words, in the center of town, in Grand Central Times Square, in the middle of the thoroughfare of our society, it's standing right in front of you, bold. Lurking at every corner. No matter where you look, it's all over the place, right? She caught him and kissed him in broad daylight. Often, this is what happened. Sin will try to shock you. It's like the hook. Wow, I can't believe she said that to me. Wow, he really thinks I'm a cat's meow or the dog's bark. Anyhow, so she sees the man. Whoa, wow. That's shocking. That's provocative. Well, I can't believe they did that. Wow, she said that to me. Or, you know, you're at work and you go, hey, John, how you doing? Oh, I'm doing fine. Oh, good to see you. Hand on your leg. Oh, good to see you too. Don't be doing that kind of nonsense. Oh, hi. You know, come on. This is so silly. Come on. Dogs do that, folks. Come on. Silly. Don't be touching someone that's not your wife. Seriously. Or her husband. That's just dumb. You would give him a hug around the neck and do the Colombian thing, that's fine, okay. But anyhow, so at times she was outside lurking. She caught him and kissed him. And she's shocked. When you're shocked, you know what you need to do? Run! Joseph was shocked. He's hanging out there, and Potiphar's wife in the book of Genesis saying, hey, you're a hunk. Hey, come lie with me. He's like, you know what? She just shocked me. I'm not going to negotiate with this. Ejection button. I'm out of here. Whew! He hot-tailed it out of there. Why? Bible says, flee sexual lust. Every other temptation's outside the body, but he who sins sexually sins against his own self. My friends, do not play with sexual sin. Do not negotiate. You will lose if you negotiate. Do not negotiate. I have self-control. Well, good for you. I'm going to flee. I'm going to run. It is not worth it. Click. Boop. If someone comes up to me, no, and this woman's kind of come. I mean, I don't have this problem that much, but because I think I don't send out the wrong signals. But someone starts talking about with me, and I'm in the airport or something like that. Yeah, look at my wife, Sandra. Isn't she beautiful? She's a Colombian princess. La, 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 look at my beautiful children. Yeah, I start dropping my wife. My wife this, my wife that. They leave me alone. And we went to marriage counseling before we got married. Good idea, by the way. And the lady told us, you're a pastor's wife. She told Sandra, when some woman starts, oh, pastor, you know, it never happens to me, but never, imagine it did. Pastor, she says, grab your husband and thrust your breast into his chest and say, hi, honey, and show him that this is your man. Get your stinking paws off of him.
Happy Valentine's.
Happy Valentine's Day. Let's end this service quickly. There's a reason I married Colombian, okay? I'll just say that. Passion. Okay, here we go. Let's move forward. That's really inappropriate. Well, no, it's not inappropriate. It's not inappropriate. Yes, that's an appropriate manner, folks. That's the way it should be. It shouldn't be about, you know, it's really, how many, this is sad. This is a little side note. I'm going to get off track here, but you go to a restaurant, people like this across the table, they must not be married. Now, you've all said that before, haven't you? Right? You go out to see, oh, a couple, they must not be married. We should be googly all over each other. Now, I'm going to put someone on the spot. I hope I don't do this, but there's a couple in our church that are totally all over each other all the time and so lovey-dovey. And they happen to be sitting over there. You know, there's a couple over there, the Wallaces. I mean, I'm sorry to put you on the spot, but they love each other so much. And they're just all, I mean, like, oh, they're like a happy couple. That's the way it should be, right? We should be showing love to each other. We should be showing exuberant love. And this is what's all, if you get shocked, run. Shock, run. Do not stick around. Do not negotiate. Get out immediately. If you're on a business trip, and someone says, let's go for drinks. Well, I don't drink. Well, just come with us anyhow. And then everyone else leaves, and it's you and her. Get out. I have to go to a business lunch. Well, go to a place that's really, really crowded. Don't go where the lights are low and you hear Kenny G in the background, okay? No. Go to a place that's bright and airy and make sure you have your wife call you. Make sure you said, oh, excuse me, I need to call my wife. Put a timer on your phone. Don't play with this, folks. It will burn you. It will burn you. When you're shocked, you need to run right away. And don't say this, I find you very attractive. That's stupid. Don't say that. We shouldn't be doing this. Don't say that either. Instead of saying we shouldn't be doing this, just get out. Just get out. Let me say something else too. Just because you have a response, I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna give an illustration because I have a little more time in the service. Okay. Who can I pick on this morning? Let me pick on my son Luke, because he's here. You're letting your son listen to this? Yes, because he hears it all day in school. Okay, here we go. Son, come on. Come on. Now, imagine I'm talking to my son, which I do, and I say, hey, Luke, how you doing? Oh, I missed. Okay, I'm going to see him. Okay, here we go. Did you feel that? Okay. Now, is he responsible for me throwing that piece of paper on him? No. He felt something. Go back down. Thank you. Pick that up, please. Okay. When someone flirts with you, they throw sexuality on you. Oh, I feel something. Big deal. If I throw water on you, you're going to get wet. If I tap, you're going to feel. Just because you respond to a stimuli does not mean you're guilty. It means you're human. Now, I may be sanctified, but I'm not petrified, right? You see, whoa, look at that, praise God. Okay, that's enough of that. It shocks you. It gets your attention. So what? I find it attractive. So what? Big deal. Yeah, you're dealing with a stimuli. Reject it. Does that make sense? Well, I felt something. Oh, big deal. You feel something. If you did everything you felt, you'd be in huge, huge trouble. So sometimes a woman or a man can throw something on you, and you might feel it. You might go in, it might be a spirit of lust. I don't know what's going on. I've been in different areas where you sense like a spirit of anger. If you go someplace, you go into someone's house for dinner, or man, there's like a spirit of anger. There's a spirit of lust that can be over a location. Because of what people are doing, it invites the demonic realm of lust. You sense that lust, walk away, run away, get out of there, call your wife, call your husband, call your mama. Okay? Can I tell my mom? Yeah, you're talking about. Okay, but anyhow, so listen to me. So don't do it. Look at verse 13. With imprudent face, she said to him, I have peace offerings with me. You know what that means? I went to church today. I brought my tithe and I gave my offerings. I taught in the Sunday school class. I served hot chocolate with whipped cream. I went to church today. I heard the sermon. I lifted my hands in worship. I cried. I even spoke in tongues. I'm real spiritual. I paid my peace offering. You know what you pay your peace offerings for? When you screw up, you give your peace offerings. So God understands we're just human. We shouldn't be doing this, but let's pray together. I've heard people say this. Oh, I know I'm committing fornication, adultery, but we pray together. Really? First of all, let me say something about prayer. Prayer is very intimate. I know couples that are married don't even pray together. Why? It's intimate. Do not pray with someone that's not your spouse. It's not wise. It's very intimate to pray with someone when you start sharing someone spiritually. She says, she says right here, so I came, where am I? Where was I? It's so juicy, I lost my place. Okay, with an imprudent face, she says, I have peace offerings with me today. Today I paid my tithes and my offerings. I've gone to church. I listened to a good message from the pastor or pastorers. And I'm doing good. I went to church today. And God understands us, because after all, we're just Christians. I went to a Christian college. Fantastic experience. But you know what happens? Oh, we're all Christians. Let's let our hair down. And we start compromising. Well, God understands. God understands, we know. And he'll forgive us. God's a God of grace, man. And so let's just go ahead and have our fun and drink, and then God will forgive us. That's what she's saying. In other words, she's Christian. With imprudent face, I have peace offerings with me. Today I paid my vows. You know what's really sad? A lot of the morality of our church, at the churches in general, not this church, but the church across town, of course, there is immorality in the church that has no difference between what's going on. Okay, now if you've made mistakes and you've crashed and burned your marriage, I'm not here to condemn anyone, but it's kind of sad that the same statistics are in the church. Why? Because we've given into this lie. We've given into this lie, okay? She says this, verse 15. And here's another lie before we get. Here's another lie. I paid my peace off. You can repent when we're done. When we're done, we'll say, oh, God, forgive me. And I've said, oh, Lord God, oh, we shouldn't have done that. I know it was wrong. It was so wrong for us. Let's pray together. Stupid. Do not pray together. Walk out. We're done. I'm blocking you. You want to unfriend someone on Facebook? Now's the time to unfriend somebody. Okay? Change the phone number if you have to. And if you're in a job with someone you don't have self-control with, quit your job. What? Yes, it's worth it. If you're in an office with someone you can't control yourself, leave. Find another job. If it's someone, listen, do not play with this, folks. This will get you and this will kill you. You're going to see in a few moments. So, peace offerings. Verse 15. So I came out to meet you diligently to seek your face. And I have found you. I have spread my bed with tapestry, colored coverings of Egypt linen. In other words, she prepared the sexual thing. She prepares herself. I perfume my bed with myrrh, aloes, and cinnamon. Come, let us take our fill of love. Here, stop right there. That's not love. That's lust. Lust can never be satisfied. Lust has an after effect called I need more and I need more intense. It's like a heroin addict. Unfortunately, heroin is on a rise around here. You know, I'll take a little heroin. Take a little heroin, you get a high, and then I do it again, and you get hooked on it. Your body becomes part of it. Then you need a higher dosage to give you the same feeling. That's what happens with sexual sin. It gets more deviant and more deviant and more deviant and more deviant. This is why the crazy stuff that happens today, you're reading the Bible, you can see what happens. Because its lust is never satisfied. It only gives you an insatiable attitude and aptitude and desire for something else that's not of God. So I came out diligently. I perfumed my bed. Come, let us fill our love until morning. That's not love, that's lust. And Valentine's Day is not about lust, it's about love. Now listen, God gave us passion. Passion's awesome. Passion is something that God has given us. When you are having sexual encounters with your spouse, that is a man and a woman, what is happening is that is done in the proper context. You walk away satisfied. And it's healthy. But if you mix pornography and mix lust in there, it's going to screw things up. The Bible says also, do not deny each other except for a season of fasting and prayer. Couples, you should get together unless the enemy comes and tempts you. Okay, that's important. So I've come, spread my bed, I perfume my bed. Come, let us fill our love until morning. Let us delight ourselves with love. Let's delight ourselves with lust. Lust disguises itself as love. Love gives. Lust takes and leaves you wanting more in a sadistic and bad way. Love gives you a feeling of, I'm satisfied, I enjoy what's happening, but I don't want to grab from somebody else. I want to give. There's a vast difference. God gave us passion. God designed passion. He designed the heartbeat. He designed all the, you know, look at the Song of Solomon. Man, you talk about it. It's not just an analogy between God and the church. Man, it is a lot. Read it. I'm going to climb into your trees and pull down the fruit. I mean, it's pretty, you know, it talks about love. It's appropriate. It's correct. Listen to this, verse 19. For my husband is not at home. He's gone on a long journey. He's taking a bag of money with him and will come home at the appointed day. In other words, we will not get caught. This is our little secret. And there's nothing greater than a secret. Bible says in Proverbs that it's stolen bread tastes better because it's stolen. You don't think you'll get caught? We won't get caught. No one's going to know about this. And God will forgive us. If we fall, God's a loving God. He's full of grace and mercy. Verse 21, with her enticing speech, she caused him to yield. So instead of running, he stopped. Oh, I wonder what's going on here. Do not negotiate with lust. Run. With her flattering lips, she seduced him. That includes men and women here. Immediately, he went after her as an ox goes to the slaughter. Now, not many of us have seen an ox go to a slaughter, but it doesn't sound like a good thing, does it? You're going to basically kill the animal and knock it. The animal has no idea. And the next thing is dead. okay? As an ox goes to slaughter, or a fool to the correction of stocks, till an owl struck his liver, a bird hastens to snare, he will not know it cost him his life. My friend, sexual sin could kill you. And it can kill you spiritually. The Bible says fornicators and adulterers will not inherit the kingdom of heaven. What? I'm one saved always. Listen, if you're doing sin and you're like, God, I don't care, I'm going to do it anyhow. I wonder if you're even saved in the first place. You're not even saved. If you can do something like that and say, I'm going to do it, I don't care the consequences, you're playing with the enemy. But you want to talk about once, you want to play around that, you want to get the crapshoot with your salvation, I am not going to do that. I'm going to play it safe. But my question is, are you even saved? If that's your attitude, maybe you're infatuated with God. Maybe you like God, but you've never given your life completely to God because you're saying, God, I don't care what you say, I'm going to do it my way. Yeah, you can turn back, but don't play with this. He says, this is what I believe. I think historical background, I believe that Solomon, some theologians say, in about four or five commentaries I read over the week, last couple of weeks, they said they believe that Solomon was literally looking through his window and saw the young man and says, call him over here. We're going to teach that man a lesson. The king is watching you and I. He sees what's going on. And make no mistake, it will cost you your life. Do not play with sexual sin. Every other sin is outside the body. But he or she sins sexually, sins against their own body. Listen to this. Verse 24. Now therefore, listen to my children. Pay attention to the words of my mouth. Do not let your heart turn. There's a responsibility. I could not help myself. No temptation has overtaken you but what is common to man. And God is faithful. He will not allow you to be tempted more than you're able to bear, but with each temptation, he'll provide an avenue of escape that you may be able to bear under it. That's scripture, folks. Don't say I had no choice. If you have a situation, you need to run. Pay attention to my words. Verse 25. Do not turn your aside to her ways. Do not stray to her paths. For she, listen to this, she has cast down and wounded many. And listen to this. And all who were slain by her were strong men. I've known people that I've looked up to. Pastors and leaders and even a president. You say, wow, what a great guy and a great woman. And you've seen these people at the pinnacle of their power and strength in business, in church, in politics, and whoever they are. Someone you really, an uncle, wow, how do they fall? They're so strong. Listen, I know people that are a lot stronger than me that have fallen. I'm not stupid enough to play with this. Well, I'm better than them. That's arrogant. Do not play with lust. You need to run. You need to run away from it. Do not give into it. Do not play with it. If you're involved with drinking and control yourself, have nothing to do with alcohol. If you're into gambling, have nothing to do with gambling. Whatever your lust thing is, whatever the mechanism is that traps you, do not negotiate. Do not play. Get out, especially with sexual sin, because God loves you and does not want to see you hurt yourself, hurt your family, and hurt other people. This is a big issue, folks. We need to deal with it. And all who were slain were strong men. Verse 27, her house is the way to hell, descending to the chambers of death. Put on your seatbelt. I know I'm saying some things that are going, whoa. One say, forget about all the silly theology arguments. When the Bible says it leads to death, the adulterers and fornicators and swindlers who do not inherit the kingdom of God, what does that mean? I don't want to find out. Okay, now as we conclude, I want to talk about lust a little bit and its definitions, okay? So, boy, this is pretty spicy, isn't it? The Bible doesn't mince any words. You know what the word lust means? It means desire. And it can be interpreted as good desire or bad desire. For example, the same word for lust used in one passage of Scripture is found in Luke 22:15. Says this, then he said to him, Jesus, with fervent desire, I have desire to eat Passover with you. Okay, that's a good desire. So God gives us desire, but it can be a good desire or a bad desire. The word could have been translated lust, but it wasn't. It was based on the context. Listen, God gave us sexuality for health within the confines of a man and woman, one lifetime, together in marriage. It's a beautiful thing. It's supposed to be celebrated and encouraged. God wants us to have health. Worldly lust, evil lust, God gave us pure desires. It says here in Galatians 5:16, I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. We need to walk in the Spirit. That's why it's so important to get the Word in you every day. When I read the Word of God, the Lord speaks to me, and it softens my heart. Get into the Word every day. Don't just come every day, every week. It's important, but get in the Word every day. Get yourself in the Word. For the lust of the flesh against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. These are contrary, okay? Romans 6:19, I speak in human terms because of the weakness of your flesh. For just as you present your members as slaves to uncleanness and lawlessness, leading to more lawlessness, so present your members as slaves to righteousness and holy. Romans 8, 5, and 6. For those who live according to the flesh, listen to this, set their minds on the things of the flesh. We need to watch what we set our minds upon. For those who live according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit, for those to be carnality or minded is death, but the spiritual minded is life and peace. Romans 13, 14. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provisions for the flesh to fulfill its lust. Don't even give it an opportunity. Don't try to replace. Don't try to stop doing something. Replace it with something good. So number one word for lust is desire. The second one is deception. And it says here, I'm going to just save time. Proverbs 6, starting at verse 30, says this. People do not despise a thief if he steals to satisfy himself when he's starving. Yet when he's found, he must restore sevenfold. He may have to give up the substance of his house. I know a lot of people that have given up the substance of their house because they want to have a good time. They lost their retirement. They lost their 401k. They lost everything. That's nothing. Verse 32, whoever commits adultery with a woman lacks understanding. He who does so destroys his own soul. Do you see that? He destroys who? His own. Her own. Wounds and dishonor he will get, and his reproach will not be wiped away. People don't despise a person for taking care of themselves when they're starving. But this is the thing. When you have lust, you're like, I can't live without you. I must have this or I'll die. You will not die. Okay? If you don't eat, you'll die. But you will not die if you do not give in to your lust. I can't help myself. Yes, you can. No, I can't. Yes, if you believe you can't, you won't. Get help. How do I get help? Well, that's why we have small groups. Not just why not call a friend? We had somebody, a dear friend of our church, and he called us and said, listen, I'm about ready to lose my mind with the situation. He called me and another man in the church. He said, pray for me. And he said afterwards, I am so thankful that I prayed. And these two guys prayed for me because I walked on the water of this thing where it normally sink me. And he attributed it to the prayers of friends because he's connected in a small group with other godly men. We need to do this. This is a battle we're in, folks. Lust is deception. Adultery never satisfies. Pornography never satisfies. Lust always wants more. Proverbs 27:20. Hell and destruction are never full, so the eyes of a man are never satisfied. We can go on and on and on. That's the next one. We'll skip a couple verses here. The third thing is death. Death. Desire, deception, and here's death. James 1:14, why is it all D's? So you remember, okay? 1 Corinthians 6:18, but each one is tempted when he's drawn away, I'm gonna ask the worship team to get ready, but each one is tempted when he's drawn away by his own desire and is enticed. Then when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, full-grown death. Proverbs 7:23, he did not know, it cost him his life. Remember Adam and Eve? You will not die. Yeah, but when they ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, what happened? They died spiritually. When you sin sexually or you give into lust, you know what happens? You start dying. It's like leprosy where you lose the ability to feel your limbs. And the next thing you know, parts of you start falling off. When you give into sin, I feel so far from God. I don't know what's going on. I don't think he exists anymore. Tim Keller was one of my favorite theologians. Redeemer Presbyterian Church in New York City, he said, when people come to me, young people come to me and says, I don't feel God. He says, are you sexually pure? He says, 9 times out of 10, they say no. Because they're not sexually pure, they feel far from God. They make provision for their flesh. When you make provision for your flesh, you begin to starve the Spirit of God in you. How many marriages are fallen? I don't love you anymore. Of course you don't love them anymore. If you're looking at pornography, if you're flirting with work, if you're getting your zing from texting and talking to people, it's not going to work. You know, there's an illustration. I want to share it with you. The indigenous people in the Northern Hemisphere. I don't want to say Eskimos. It's not politically correct. I've been told how you kill a polar bear. What they do is they take a spear, sharpen it, and they put ice on it. They put herring on there and fish. And at night, the polar bear comes out, smells the herring, is tempted by it, begins to lick it. And as he licks it, the tongue is cut, and the warm blood oozes over the ice, melts the ice. More the herring is smelled and tasted. And it continues to lick it more and more and more until the lifeblood comes out of that bear. And the morning after, they find that polar bear dead. That's what lust will do to you and I. Flee sexual lust. Bible says we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. There are people in this church that have gotten free of pornography, gotten free of adultery, gotten free of substance abuse. We should be helping each other out. If you have a good marriage, help someone that has a bad marriage. Listen, we're here to help each other out, guys. We're all in this together. Bible says, Philippians 4:8, whatever is true, we can go on about that. Whatever is true, whatever is noble, think on these things. You know what a stronghold is? I conclude with this. Stronghold is this. A stronghold is a fortress that you run to in times of trouble. Psalm 18:2, the Lord is my rock and my fortress, my deliverer, my God, my strength, in whom I will trust, my shield, the horn of my salvation. You know what happens when you're worried? How about this? You're stressed out. I need to run to my fortress. And some of you guys run to gambling. You might run to sexual stuff. You might run to flirting. Why not run to something that's healthy? Run to God. Run to proper relationships. It's a prison. The Bible says in 1 Peter 2:11, beloved, I beg you, as sojourners of people that are passing through, this is not where we're settling down. We're only passing through this life. We're sojourners. Abstain from fleshly lusts, which war against the soul. I know great pastors that have lost everything. Guy was anointed. People got healed under his ministry. Tremendous things happened, but he kept playing around. You know what? He lost his family. He lost his money. He lost everything. His kids want nothing to do with him, and he's a broken man today. Is it worth it? No, it's not worth it. The Bible says this, confess your trespass to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. James 5:16, listen, guys, whatever you're doing, guys, if you're on this lust path, stop it. Get help. How do I get help? Well, first of all, you got to get in the light. I could preach on and on. I got to close this out here. Get help. We have a connection card here today. You know, it says, I'll give my life to Christ today. So, you know, so, I need prayer. I need to make an appointment. Listen, we'll help you out. We'll find some way to help you out. If someone wants to get help, we'll do everything in our power as a church to help you. Guaranteed. But you need to face up to what's going on. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, I know this has been a tough message, and Lord, I preach it with a lot of humility because, Lord, I know that I'm a human being, I'm a man, and I recognize the fact that the enemy likes to use these things. And Lord, I stand up here today no better than anyone in this congregation. Lord, we're all in deep need of you. And Father, I just pray that you just forgive us right now in Jesus' name. Lord, we ask for forgiveness for buying the lie of lust. I pray you deliver us from lust, that we run to lust, that we would begin to make the right choice of life in Jesus' name. Father, I pray for freedom to come upon marriages, freedom upon young men, young women, single men, single women. Father, that they be free. We pray for protection upon families. Lord, we know how to protect our children from the arsenic of the stuff that will kill us. We choose life instead of death in Jesus' name. With every head bowed, I'm going to ask you a question. Have you given your life to Jesus Christ? Listen, this does not work by yourself. Not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, I will give you strength, the Lord says. The only way you're going to get through this is through Jesus Christ. Have you given your life to Christ? One day, you're going to have to face God. It's not what you've done, it's what God's done for you. You are not good enough. I'm not good enough. Only what Jesus has done pays the price for us for our sins to be wiped away, that we can face God as if we've never sinned. That's called Jesus Christ. The greatest love ever given was for God so loved the world that he stretched his arms, his left arm and his right arm on a cross. He says, I love you this much. I give you my life. If you accept Jesus Christ today, you can begin a new day. I'm going to pray a prayer. Every head bowed. I'm going to pray a prayer right now. If you pray this prayer with your heart, with sincerity, if you've, maybe you've fallen away from God and you need to come back, or maybe you've never done it before, you've just come today because you were invited. Let's pray this prayer together, and today can be a new day. Lord Jesus, I thank you for dying on the cross for me. I ask you to wash me of all of my sins, and I choose from this day forward to follow you by your help. Forgive me, I pray. Thank you that I am now your child. Not what I've done, but what I've received. I receive your forgiveness, and I receive that I am now a child of you. In Jesus' name, I give my life to you today, in Jesus' name. With every head bowed, I said, Pastor, I prayed that prayer today for the first time, or I made a recommitment. See, quick, come on, let's be bold here this morning. Pastor, I prayed that prayer. Anyone this morning, say, Pastor, it's me. Maybe some people are online. Let's all stand if we could. I'm going to ask, I know we ran a little longer today. There's a lot we did today in the service, and we're going to ask the prayer team to make their way down. You need prayer for anything at all. We want to pray for you. If you made that decision today, fill this card out, put it in one of the boxes. I'm going to ask the prayer team to make their way up. So we sing one more song, The Love of Jesus. The Lord bless you and keep you. Let's walk in his freedom today. If you need prayer, come forward to band. If they want to play, they can. We're dismissing you, but if you want prayer, come forward. God bless you. Have some hot chocolate.